This edition of Computer Club Lesson was recorded on November the 9th, 2015. Enjoy! Hello, welcome to Computer Club Lesson. This episode is brought to you by the Binary Guys. Okay, as I said before the class started, I have prepared absolutely nothing because I was a lazy lout. I don't have anything here or here. So, I've called for questions about anything that has been bedeviling you for a long, long time and you haven't been able to ask. And the first one that we have is about your email client. The question was, can you recover a deleted email? Yeah. It all depends on the client and how you've set it up in the first place. In Microsoft Outlook, by default, when you set up Outlook and you set up your email, when you delete an email from the inbox folder, and you highlight the email, click on the X, and it goes to deleted items. It stays there until you go into the deleted items folder and highlight the emails there and delete them again. Okay? That's Microsoft Outlook. All right? You can change that setting to delete or empty deleted items on exit. So if you close Microsoft Outlook, it will empty the folder. Then your deleted email is gone, unrecoverable.
What do you mean by if you close?
If you close Outlook or Outlook Express, whichever you were using, Microsoft Outlook, and this is the one that comes with your Office suite, okay? It's simply closing the program. And if it is set to do that, it will empty the deleted items folder and you're done. Now, there is a setting for all email clients, except in this case, which is very special, where you can tell the email client, do not delete remove a deleted email from the server for 5 days, 10 days, or how many days you want. And it will be, that setting will be under the Accounts tab or wherever you're going to find it, and the properties for your email account. Okay, you'll have to look around for it, but what you're looking for is the properties for your email account. And then once you found that, under the Advanced tab, where it tells you where your email servers are located and the ports that they're working on, down here near the bottom of that panel, there will be an entry for keep deleted emails for number of days. When you put a checkbox in there, you can change the number of days. If there's no checkbox, when the emails download, they're gone from the server. But you can tell the server, hang on to these for a little while.
Is there a limit of time?
You tell it the limit, okay? It's and any number of days. Now, that comes in handy when you've deleted an email and you think it's gone from your local machine, and it is. You can log into the webmail for Source, Kojiko, whoever you have your mail with. You can log in, and there are all those old emails from 5 days ago, 10 days ago, whatever, they're there.
How long do they usually keep them?
Well, you've told your local email client, delete them after 5 days.
Oh, okay.
All right. So this is just sort of an extra added protection for you. If you accidentally delete one locally from your computer, you have an opportunity to go to the email server and see it there. Okay, you don't have the opportunity to download it again unless you have another email client in your house on another computer like your tablet or your phone, and you're downloading a second time to that. So yes, it can be done, but ordinarily, when an email is deleted from a local client, it's gone. I said this is special. This is special. This is not pop mail. This is IMAP mail. And this local client...
What is the difference between pop and IMAP?
Pop, post office protocol, is when your email client manipulates your post office, your email server, to download your email, send your email that you've created on your computer, a one-shot deal. It downloads and it removes the email from the server. You send mail, it sends it through the server. It's a one-shot deal. Under IMAP, what you really got is you have a representation of webmail. It's a representation of your webmail, like Gmail, like Yahoo, or even some services like Kojiko and Source and Rogers allow for IMAP connections to their email servers when you finally get that. But I would say don't do that. This is a special case for Gmail and for Yahoo Mail. You want to enable them on your computer locally as IMAP. And what that really means is if you make a change in the email that you have locally, it immediately makes that change on the Gmail website. Okay? They are in constant contact, almost in real time. So if I was to delete this email here, it would be moved to the trash folder immediately on the Gmail website.
What if you don't have Gmail?
If you have other services that have internet mail services like Yahoo, Outlook, Hotmail, they can all be done as IMAP. And like I said, some local email services like Kojiko and Source can be done in IMAP. I don't recommend them. Only the big services like Gmail, Yahoo, and Outlook. Okay.
Would it automatically be IMAP? Because I haven't touched my Gmail since we use it.
Yeah, if I set up your email local client, which is Outlook, right? If I set it up to connect to Gmail, it can only connect as IMAP. All right? Which makes it real easy. Yes, you do it during the setup. In the case of Windows Live Mail, if you're setting up a Gmail account or a Hotmail account or an Outlook account, it does it almost by itself. Okay? You just put in your information, your email address, your password, and what name you want to be known by. It's georgebags@outlook.com. When you say connect or set up the email account, it goes to Outlook.com and it gets all of the permissions and all of the setups that you need to make it work on a local email client. It does it all by itself. Boom. Okay. Some of the others, like Source and local internet service providers, that all has to be done by hand. And these numbers that I showed you here that were available here in the Advanced tab, all of that has to be put in by hand. You have to put in the check marks at the right place. These numbers have to be absolutely correct. If they're not, it won't work. But for Outlook and for Gmail and Hotmail and Yahoo Mail, they just work. Okay? So you can do that.
My Gmail told me yesterday that if I just erase something, it wouldn't be gone.
Yeah, it'll be in there somewhere. I tell my trash folder not to do anything with email, with trashed email, for 30 days. So I have trashy email in there from trash from 30 days ago. Okay? And 31 days from now, it will delete all of these heroes for today.
Okay? Does Archive do the same thing?
Archive is quite different. Now, you can archive your deleted folder. I don't recommend it, but you can. Archive is for Microsoft Outlook. There is no archive for Windows Live Mail.
But there is for Gmail.
Well, no, not really. What you're doing is you're just saving everything. Okay? If you want to save an email forever, you can make a folder called Hold This Forever and put whatever email that you get in that folder, and it will hold it forever. If it's a spam email and you move it to the trash folder, it will disappear in 30 days. Okay? Unless you go in and tell it empty trash. But that's for IMAP. That's for IMAP. You can tell folders, or you can tell the IMAP email client to hang on to mail forever. Okay? And when you've got lots of storage, like I've got 15 gigabytes of email storage. Okay? That's a lifetime's worth. I'm not going to lose anything. Ever. And it's all searchable. So, okay, let's see if I can bring up Outlook.com. I have it here somewhere. There we go.
What's your question? How do you send in an attachment?
Yeah, sending an attachment. Outlook, almost there. Okay. All right, this is my Outlook account that I set up when I set up this computer. I can have this account, by the way, on any computer that I own, because it's all on the web. I'm logging into a web page. Okay. But let's talk about sending emails to folk. Okay, I have clicked on this email to open it up, but you'll notice that when the email looked like this, when I first logged in, there wasn't really much here, okay? But as soon as I clicked on the email and highlighted it, I got these folders, new, reply, delete, archive, whatever, okay? So let's talk about making a new email. So I'm going to click on new, and it's going to say who it's from. It's from me, and I'm just going to put in an address here, I'm not going to send it to, okay, I'll send it to my daughter, okay? And you put in a subject line, and we'll put in attach. Now we want to make an attachment to this email. And we're doing it in Outlook on the web page. And up here at the top is a little paperclip with the word attach. Okay? If you're making a new email, it's there. You'll have to look around for it, maybe. But if you're making a new email, it's there. Okay? The little paperclip is the universal sign for attach something to this, because that's what you would do with a piece of paper. Get out a paperclip, attach another piece of paper to the old paper. That's what you're doing here. Okay? You're making an attachment to a letter, and you do that with a paperclip. So there it is, attach. So once you click on attach, it will say, well, where do you want to find these files? Well, I want to look on my computer. So it's now I can navigate through my computer to find what I want. A picture, a document, whatever. Okay? This is for webmail. And for the most part, all of these webmails are the same. If you log into Gmail and you want to compose a new email in Gmail, if you look around carefully in the window that you've opened to compose that email, you'll find that paperclip. That's where you make attachments. You can attach as many things as you want to an email. 10 things, 20 things, 100 things. So long as the files are not too big, you can make as many attachments as you want. I would say no more than 3 or 4, because if somebody has to download them, okay, it can make problems. It's not going to make a problem if they're logging into another Gmail site like you're using. But if they have to download it, they have to download attachments, sometimes it's problematic. So there, yes?
What's the difference between that Outlook and the Outlook on the app?
You mean the Mail app in Windows 10?
Yeah.
Not much. Yeah, it may very well be, but when you start looking around for how you do things, how do I get out of this? Cancel should get me out of it. Yeah, there we go. When you start looking around, you've opened the app. I don't use the app, so I'm really not familiar with it. But once you open the app and you highlight something, then these things should start to appear.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay? They should start to appear.
Is there a difference, like you're saying, this one's the webmail? No.
In fact, the app is talking to, is set up IMAP, so it's talking directly to the website. Okay? In fact, that's what's happening.
Yeah. What does IMAP stand for? Like the other one you told us.
You would have to ask that.
No, because you told us POP means Post Office Protocol.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's look it up. Let's look it up. So
Google.
Yeah, I'm going to Google it, and I'll get it there for you.
Okay.
IMAP. Internet Message Access Protocol.
Internet Message
Access Protocol. And what it really means, as I said before, is that the Internet Message Access Protocol is accessing the your web mail server in real time. So a change you make this second is reflected on the mail server this second. In PopMail, that's not the case. You download your mail. Yeah, the mail is downloaded and removed from the mail server right away, But beyond that, that's all it's doing. That's all it's doing. It's just downloading your mail. So, there's that. Now, have we beaten up email to death here? Okay, one more.
Question. I have an email, and it's called Echo123, and it's apparently a Skype sound test.
Yes.
But what it's done is embedded into my contact list, and I cannot delete it from the contact list. I don't know why. When I click on it, right-click on it, the delete and the edit contacts and manage all fade, and you can't. They want me to contact.
I think that's probably because Skype is now integrated almost fully into your computer. It's and that's Microsoft Office once you load it. The all of the programs, once you load them onto a Windows computer, integrate fully with the computer. And sometimes it's really difficult to make those programs do what you want rather than what they want. Okay. How you would get rid of it,
hopefully I'm not. If I don't do anything, it'll just disappear.
No, it's not going to disappear. It'll be there forever.
Yeah. How dare it go into my contacts? You know,
I mean, yeah, well, that makes a whole lot of sense. Because let us say that you have 20 or 30 Skype contacts, okay? And they go into your contact list, okay? They should be there as integrated into Skype. So when you click on them, it will ask you, do you want to open Skype to talk to this person? Okay? Rather than send them an email, all that might be there is their Skype address. And then it'll ask you, you want to open Skype to talk? It's doing the same thing with that Echo. All right? Yes, sir.
I can't find my contact list, you know, which is long.
Yeah.
If I start to type in, if I'm sending a new one,
yeah.
Start to type in, three or four will show up.
Yeah, then you have to pick the right one.
But I want to get the whole list.
Oh, you want to get the whole list.
And I can't find it. If I go to contact on the left side,
yep.
I get one address.
Okay, now what are you using for mail?
Hotmail.
Hotmail. So you're using Outlook.com?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's bum. This is probably not going to show me what I want. Okay. In Outlook.com, somewhere on that page, you should have an icon that looks like this, that it has little tiny squares in it.
Yeah.
Okay. That is your contact list. That's your people. If you click on there, that's the apps. And it will then show you the people that are there. Now it's loading up my contacts here, and there they go. So if I was to start making a new email in Outlook, and I wanted to send an email to Adorable Pets, I would just ADOR and Adorable Pets will pop right up. That's what you're doing, right? When you go back to the page and you're in your email here, you're in mail, okay, and you want to make a new email, okay? So you're going to go to new.
Well, and it was a good book.
Then you should be able to go to click on the to button. And it should show you everything.
What did you say the button is?
Two. T-O. Who are you sending it to?
Okay.
All right. And by the way, by default in Outlook, the carbon copy and the blank carbon copy are not there. So if you want to send an email to one person and a carbon copy to 10 others, you would just click on that CC and it opens up the CC line. And if you click on the CC line, it will then open up your address book where you can choose the addresses to the carbon copy.
Suppose you only want six of them. You only want six of them. Do you have to choose them individually?
Yes, in this case you do. In a local email client, you can choose them from a list or you can choose them by doing control click on the name and it will choose them individually, but in the website you're pretty much stuck with
unless they're in a group.
Yeah, unless you've put them in a group. Okay. Oops. Let me see here. We'll just try it one more time. Yeah, I'm in the on the web page. You have to do them individually. Okay. So. That's how that is going to look. And we'll get out of that now. Leave this page. So it's all gone. All right, I think we've beaten email to death here. Let's get some other problems. Okay, you got another problem besides an email problem?
Yeah.
All right, let's have it. Yes.
It does not work on my computer.
It doesn't?
No.
What does it do if you do Control-Alt-Delete?
Absolutely nothing.
Is it?
I get into trouble, the other day, what I was trying to do, I was in the game.
Yeah.
Everything froze. My mouse froze. Everything froze. And I did Control-Alt-Delete. Nothing happened.
Nothing happened.
Nothing. Now, I have them FN
keys. Yes, the function keys. Yeah.
Close active item, and then you shut down.
Yeah.
But to get that blue screen that you get on there, you know how it has, I think there's five items?
Yeah.
At the bottom?
Yeah. Okay, here we go. I've opened up a web browser. And let us say that this thing has hung up and crashed and it's taken over the computer and you're stuck. Okay. There are two ways to handle this. And you're right. One way is to do Control F or Alt F4. It was Alt F4, wasn't it?
Alt
F4. Yeah. So you hold down the Alt key and you tap the F4 key. And Alt F4 simply closes the active program. Alt F4. Hold down the Alt key, tap F4. It closes the active program. The one you're looking at.
Yeah.
Okay? If there's another program in the background, it doesn't affect that one. Just the active program that's in the foreground. That's the one it closes. The other way to handle this for programs that are misbehaving and they've taken over your computer, and if Alt F4 doesn't work, and sometimes it doesn't, it gets so tightly grabbed a hold of that is not going to work. The other thing that you can do is come down here to your taskbar.
No,
Yeah, okay. But that's where you can try. You can right-click, and if you right-click, then the task manager should be there and turn up. In your case, if none of this worked, then you're into a hard boot. In other words, hold down the on off button until the computer just stops. It takes about 3 or 4 seconds. Sometimes computers will get so messed up that's the only out you have. It's your last resort.
Right.
It's the last thing you should try, because the computer is in the middle of doing something. If it's stuck like that, it's in the middle of doing something. If it's in the middle of writing something to your hard drive, and you do that, whatever it was writing, it's going to stop writing right in the middle of it, and it won't have a chance to finish the file it was writing to. And if that file is important, then it can make a mess, make your computer unbootable. That's why that's a last resort.
Okay, that's what I did. I did.
Yeah. Like I said,
now my start menu and Cortana are not working, and I can't get into the computer, and a little screen comes up now. As soon as I go to sign in, it's telling me that it's crucial that the start menu and Cortana are not working. Now, last night when I went into the computer, I tried the start menu, I tried Cortana, I tried everything on the taskbar. Nothing would work.
Yeah.
I couldn't get out, but I was thinking, I right-clicked on the start menu, the bottom thing, the little thing, and it gave me the control panel.
Good.
Like all that come up. So there was a spot in there that I could shut the computer down from.
Yep. Okay. Now it gave you control panel.
Yeah. See, the control panel is in there.
Right? And it should be able to give you some other things that you can use. I mean, if this is messed up the way I think it is, you might be able to get it unmessed up by doing a system restore. All right? That's what I would do. I would do a system restore. Let me just see here. In programs and features, it should be there, right? Okay, let's open programs and features.
That's on the start menu.
Yes. That's by right clicking on the start menu. This is for Windows 10. Bum 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 bum. Nope, not here. Let me see. I may have to think about this for a little while here. System. It'll be under system. Yeah. System. And advanced system protection. And okay. If you go into system protection and it's available, it's not available on this one. I don't know why, but there it is, system restore right there. If that's not grayed out, you're home free. You can restore to a date before all this happened. Okay, you're home free. But beyond that, I'm not sure how you would get it if Cortana's not working, and your desktop is not there.
See, there's all command prompt and all that.
Yeah.
You know what? You don't know nothing about
You might be wise to be a little wary of this stuff.
Yeah.
If you want me to try and do something with it, I think I can. I think I can get it back to with System Restore, but it may take a little butting around with to get it to do it. Why my System Restore is not there, I don't know. It may be turned off by default. Maybe yours is too. It's hard to say.
Could be, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's a problem for further investigation.
You know, I think when you go into maintenance, the security and maintenance, and then you click down the little maintenance thing.
Yeah.
I think there's a restore spot in there, but I'm not positive on that.
Which is where here?
Control panel.
Oh, okay. Yeah. We just have another quick look in there. No, this just wants to change the settings. The other thing that this will do is you can refresh your PC without affecting your files. Okay? Yeah. So what refresh does is if you have programming that you've put in since you loaded it, that programming will probably go away. But the all of your documents and files and pictures and music and all of that stuff will remain okay. What this does is it brings your computer back to a place where it's usable again. If something got damaged, it tries to repair it with a new load of the program. What System Restore does is it looks at how the computer was configured yesterday, the day before. You choose that date, and it goes through the registry and says, okay, I'm going to put everything back the way it was in the registry. Now, the registry is the brains of the outfit. It's the brains of the outfit. The smallest little changes are changes in the registry that tell the computer exactly how to work. So you can go back a few days and put back these registry entries the way they were. This is System Restore. Okay? But you can try, if you can't make System Restore work, then you're stuck with recovery. Rather than reload Windows, which can be problematic. Yes?
Can you use that F8 key to get out of a froze up mess and then start Windows again?
Windows 10?
No.
Windows 7?
7 or 8.
Yes, yeah. You're going to restart your computer, tap the F8 key, as it's starting, and that then you can get to safe mode with networking. That's where you want to be. You can do a System Restore from safe mode with networking.
Right. You can't do that in 10?
No. It's a different process. The process has to be available to you unless you really, really trick the computer. And that's for guys like me to really trick it into thinking it's something else other than what it is. Okay, I don't think we can take that any further. If it comes down to it, you may have to give it to me. Yes?
I felt you didn't finish the attach question.
Yes.
We hit attach, but we didn't see how you did it.
Oh.
We are. How do you move
Okay, we'll do it one more time.
Is that too easy a question?
No, there is no easy question. This gets harder as you go. Okay, so here I have opened up Outlook, and as I said before, there's nothing here but new, okay? And that doesn't do anything until you highlight an email. Okay? Then it starts populating this here. Okay? So I'm going to do new. We're going to make a new email. And right off the bat for you, I'm going to attach something. Okay? So we click on the attachment icon. And it's going to ask you, where do you want to attach the file from? In your case, you want to attach it from your computer, okay? And it's asking you, well, you want to attach it from OneDrive or from your computer? You always want to attach something from your computer. Because that's where it is.
I would have said from...
No, you have nothing saved to OneDrive. It's all on your computer. It's trying to be as helpful as it can. Your computer? Yeah, right. Your computer? Yeah, right. Okay, so we'll do that. So we click on that. Now it opens up a panel, which is an Explorer panel, for all intents and purposes, where you can navigate to the files you want. Are they in your documents? Is it on your desktop? Did you download it? Okay, you click on those things there, and you find the file you want, and then... Okay, we'll go back here one more time. Just simply click on computer, and it opens up a File Explorer window. Okay? Then you can choose the file you want. In this case, I'm going to use Lesson RTF. And when I clicked on Lesson RTF, it put the file name right in here. Okay? And when I say open, what's it done? It's asked me, what do you want to do this? In this case, you go back to what you were trying to do, attach as a copy. Okay? You don't want to mess around with OneDrive or anything, you're trying to attach something. So there you go. And then we look in the body of the email message, and there is our Lesson RTF, the attachment. Okay? Go to 2. Pick somebody, send. Okay?
So the person who receives it takes on that mirror.
Yeah. They will either get the attachment in line, it will be part of the email, or they will have this icon which they can click on and download the attachment from email or load it onto the computer from mail.
Windows 7?
Yeah. How they get your attachment is their business. You've sent it. It's their business. You did it correctly. You sent it correctly. If they want it, they got to figure out how to get it. You're going to be of no help that way. Okay. So. Okay. Yes.
Java and blah blah and everything else. Before I went home and started monkeying around putting a Java in, searching for Internet Explorer, I went to Google and asked it a few questions.
Yes.
And it turns out Microsoft Edge and Google Chrome do not need plugins.
No, they don't.
So I'm not going to put Internet
no.
Explorer.
No, they don't. It's not a question of they don't need them. They don't use them.
They
Yeah, and so if you have a file that won't play in Chrome or Microsoft Edge, tough luck for you if you're not going to put on Java.
Yeah. I mean, the Java is built in. I couldn't even find it.
Yeah, there is a form of Java built in.
It's built in.
Yeah. And that should update itself with Windows updates. Before with Windows 7 and further back, there was a form of Java from Microsoft built into Windows 7. Often as not, it would not work on more modern websites. So the computer would tell you, well, the Java you have needs to be updated. So it would take you to java.com for the update. So now you're working with Oracle's Java, not Microsoft's Java.
I see, yes, okay.
All right?
Yeah.
There was a Microsoft Java, and then there was a Sun Microsystems Oracle Java, which is the real Java.
Yeah.
Okay? But if the newer computers don't use it, they don't want it, they're working fine without it. If there's something on there you really, really have to do with Java, you have to do it through Internet Explorer and a full-on copy of Java. Yes?
In the Office program, I have an older version of the Office program.
Yeah.
And in Word and in the spreadsheet, there would be pre-set up programs that you can click on and you
yes.
have to set it all up yourself. Since I put Windows 10 on, the spreadsheet works fine and the Word works fine, but when I try to go to those, it says you have to go to the web to get them and it won't go there.
You have to get them as updates. Is that what it's saying? You have to get them as updates to the program?
It says you have to put your disk back in if you have
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. So Office 10, that's what you're using, right? Microsoft Office 2010 or 13?
13.
Yeah. They may not be available in the stripped down version of Office that you're using. And so you have to get those as updates or upgrades from Microsoft
okay.
as part of the program. And if it's not going there, that's something I don't do, so you'll have to figure that one out for yourself. From Google is your friend. Okay. Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
In the corner of my screen forever, there's a warning. I'm at risk. How do I get rid of that? Every time I put it on the screen, up it comes.
Okay. It's down here in this lower part of your screen, right?
Oh,
down in there,
square. It's
a little square that says you're at risk.
Yep.
Ignore it completely. It's not lying to you. It's not lying to you.
Uh-oh.
What it's really telling you is that there is a configuration issue with your computer. But if your computer is working just fine, you can ignore those. Those are notifications about how your computer should be set up. But if it's not set that way, it's going to complain. But it will work just fine, and you're not at risk.
Thank you.
In my notification, I got a thing that says AMD Catalyst Control Center.
Yep.
That's a driver, a device driver.
Yep.
Wants me to open it and apply and video quality, blah, blah, blah.
Ignore it unless you are playing Far Cry.
I'm not.
Okay.
Ignore. Thank you. Just stop telling me these
yes.
notifications.
The notifications, that's your computer trying to be helpful.
Okay.
All right. All right. Trying to be helpful. The more you get to learn and understand about computers, the less helpful they become.
Do I need new Windows drivers?
No. I don't know how many times I must tell you this, but if your computer works, you do not need updated drivers. Okay? If it's complaining that you need updated drivers, there's a program on your computer that must be removed. Okay, and that program is in all probability in your control panel. And in your control panel, you're going to go to Programs and Features. And in that list will be some will be a program with the name driver in it. Driver update, driver repair, driver something or other. This is a program that snuck onto your computer and it's trying to get you to do things. Okay? And some of the things it's trying to get you to do are to update your drivers. Well, if you update your drivers, it's going to try and be really, really helpful, and it's going to say, we've noticed that you like to have your drivers updated all of the time. Well, perhaps you would like to have blah, blah, blah along with it.
Windows 10.
Well, if you say, yes, I'd like blah, 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 then you're going to be in a world of hurt and tears. Okay, so any program that you find in Programs and Features with the word driver in it, remove that.
Oh, so like uninstall?
Yes, yeah.
There's a little thing that shows up on the screen. I don't know, it's in with Infini or something. It's got a little wheel, and I have no idea what it is. And if you click on it, it doesn't tell me what it is, but it says, if you close this, it may affect your computer.
Yes, that may be a program that's trying to load in the background and it's having trouble. What happens if you just leave it for a minute? Does it eventually go away or does it just stay there forever?
It stays on my screen. It's on my start screen.
Okay.
I'll get the actual name of it.
Yeah, I can't tell you anything about it if I don't know the exact name.
I'll get
it. All right, so that's driver update. Driver update is what we call a PUP. P-U-P. Possibly unwanted program. Okay, all right. If your computer says you have a PUP, that's what you have, a possible unwanted program. And driver updates are one of them. Okay. Anything else?
Huh.
Yes, ma'am.
Every time I log out and say, not even just sleep, but what's that final one? Close down the
computer, it always gives me a message that it will
shut down and install updates. But yes. It never is any installation. It just keeps saying that every time I get out.
Okay, then perhaps Windows Update is damaged. You're talking about Windows 7?
Yes.
Yeah, I think Windows Update is damaged, and that's why it's doing that. How long has it been doing it for?
2 months.
Yeah. It's probably damaged. That takes a guy like me to fix it. If you want to do a full Windows 10 upgrade, I think that you're probably better to do the Windows 10 upgrade than to put up with that, without it being repaired.
But I would need you there because I don't want to install Windows 10 because I don't even know the menus up there.
Yeah.
It would be a bit of a learning curve.
Yes, I'm afraid it would be. But in your case, where Windows upgrade is damaged, or not upgrade, but update is damaged, then the only way to repair it really is to put in a new operating system, and that's to upgrade to Windows 10.
Next question, would I then be better off also getting the Office 10 suite, or that monthly or yearly rental type of thing?
All depends on what you're going to do.
Well,
now,
Word a lot, Excel a lot.
Yep. And might I make a suggestion that you do not need any of them?
Okay. It works under Windows 10.
Yes. There is a There is a program, I believe I put it on here.
This is instead of Office?
Yes. This is called LibreOffice.
It's excellent.
Yeah. It is excellent.
I love it.
Libra. LibreOffice. 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 Office. It has all of the richness of Microsoft Office 10. It doesn't have the richness of 13 or the latest, you know, versions of it. But look at it this way. If you use Microsoft Office as just a general user, you are only going to use about 10% of the capabilities of the Office suite. If that's the case, why would you want to have the absolute latest and greatest of all of the different ways that you can make an Excel pivot table when you don't even know what an Excel pivot table is? Okay, so that's where we want to look at LibreOffice.
Okay, how do you get to it?
LibreOffice is a download that you can make onto your computer from LibreOffice.org.
But do you have to have 10 to do that?
No. It will work on just about everything.
But does it mess with Office right now? No.
It's an entirely separate program. If you don't want to use Office anymore, or you don't want to buy it, this is a great alternative.
Okay. So one can
look at
it.
Yeah.
You pay for it.
No, it's free. Now you can see that here it's trying to load and it's not going to. That's because this computer is old and it's doing a lot of things in the background, and it's kind of stuck. But here it comes eventually. So you, with LibreOffice, you can write a document, you can make a spreadsheet, you can make a presentation as you would in Microsoft Office. The only thing that it does not have is mail integration. But you don't need that.
Oh, you mean you can't attach anything?
Oh yeah, you can attach everything, but it doesn't have integration. In Microsoft Office, you have the ability to make an appointment, okay, in your calendar. Well, that can be integrated into your email. So it can send a reminder to the appropriate person that you have an appointment with them in a day or two. That's integration. None of that integration lies here, but like I said, that's part of the 90% of Office that you will never use.
Another question. Right now, I've always been with Microsoft, but can you still switch the languages? There's a sort of a feature at the bottom where you can go from German to English to French or so.
I believe there is. I don't do that, but you would have to look at it. You would have to look at it, but I believe you can switch languages very easily.
Even with that other one.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. We're just about at the end of our hour here. I will endeavor to have this up on the web for you in the next day or two. And if you have any other questions that you need answered right away, you can send me an email, and I'll endeavor to answer your questions on an email in the next little while. Thank you so much. That's Computer Club Listen for today. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.